I wanted to crash the Metropolitan Museum of Art's annual fashion gala. Which is an extremely important fundraising event for the Metropolitan Museum of Art's Fashion Institute, and is an extremely highly visible social event, not only for New York City, but for the whole country. I wanted to crash it wearing some of my finest, most colorful homemade clothing, which I'm wearing now, under a homemade crystal clear plastic raincoat. Since clear plastic raincoats are starting to come back into vogue in the fashion world, especially in Europe. I wanted to crash the gala by wearing these while riding my bicycle right into the foyer of the Metropolitan Museum of Arts while the guests were doing their ballroom dancing. I decided to rehearse my bicycle riding in style here on Chuckanut Drive, here in Bellingham, Washington, 3,000 miles away, so that the people back in New York City would have no idea what was coming to them for the gala this year. Well, I had a little problem. While I was rehearsing riding my bicycle to the fashion gala, I wanted to do it here on Chuckanut Drive, and I was riding my bicycle along, and I realized I had some lint on my shorts. So I tried to pick the lint off my shorts while riding my bicycle, and I lost control and I fell into a ditch here on Chuckanut Drive while rehearsing to ride my bicycle to the gala. Well, my shorts got a lot of mud on them, and my new clear plastic raincoat got a big rip. So, be as it may, I figure I'll take this opportunity to make a video of making a new clear plastic raincoat. Now, I hope to try again to crash the gala in New York next year. If I'm successful, well, I don't have to do my own video. I will be in the media. Now that I've ruined the raincoat I had during the accident on Chuckanut Drive, obviously I need to make myself a new transparent plastic raincoat. Well, let's kill two whatever with one stone. And while I make my new raincoat, I'm going to videotape myself doing it and explain what I'm doing so that hopefully you will have not only the knowledge, but the courage and the energy to make your own clear plastic raincoat. And that has advantages. First of all, it will be your size and it will be your style. And most importantly, you can be proud that you made it. It is a foregone conclusion that the sizes and styles of rainwear that's offered by the store is extremely inadequate, and it's guaranteed that you will not find your size and or style while shopping. Now, before we go any further, I'd like to point out that because I've gotten a lot of requests for information on how I make my raincoats and requests for commissions, I am unable to make raincoats for others on commission because I have an enormous number of projects that are waiting to be made, such as more homemade clothing for myself, more lighted raincoats for myself, maybe a new bicycle trailer I have to weld together, maybe even a new bicycle so I can put together and then crash it on Chuckanut Drive, maybe a homemade oscilloscope so I can see what the sound waves in my voice look like when I'm singing, and who knows what all. However, if you have any questions after you watch this video, I might be able to give you some answers depending upon time. You feel free to email me. My email is Allyn, A-L-L-Y-N, at well.com. Of course, if you want ideas of styles of rainwear, you can look at my own artistic journal, which is simply clearplastic.com. That's one word, clearplastic.com. So, moving on, I would like to first of all suggest, if at all possible, use an industrial sewing machine similar to this. This happens to be a Brother machine. If you use an industrial machine, it is best to find one with a walking foot or a walking needle. Now, I know that most of you will not have access to such a machine, but here's a little bit of an unorthodox suggestion. You probably go to the cleaners to have your clothes cleaned. Well, let's try something. When you take your next clothes to the cleaners, take a couple of kegs of beer and a few slices of pizza for the staff at your local dry cleaners. Perhaps with that gratuity, they just might allow you to use their industrial sewing machine that they use for doing repairs on the clothing for their customers. Who knows, it may work. For those of you who are stuck with a home sewing machine or a domestic machine, here are my suggestions. First and foremost, please take it slow. When I say slow, at most, maybe 5 stitches per second. Most likely, you're going to go at the rate of maybe 1 stitch per second. In some critical places, such as the collar and the sleeves, you may end up going at 1 stitch every 2, 3, or even 5 seconds. You will need to help push the material through the feed dog of the machine, because in a home sewing machine, the pressure of the foot, which is controlled usually by a screw in the top, will not be enough even if the screw is in all the way. I'm hoping to remember as I go through this journey to point out areas where it would be especially difficult with a domestic sewing machine, and hopefully I can point out some possible alternatives. In addition to the sewing machine, of course, you will need the material. Vinyl is available by the yard at any decent size fabric store. My favorite is this, glass clear, window clear or crystal clear vinyl. This is 10 gauge. It was quite thick, but it's extremely durable. I like it because with my homemade clothing, of course, I always want to let my beauty shine in the rain. If you really get stuck up on trying to find material, try sending me an email and I just might be able to sell you some of this material I would have left over, but I cannot make any guarantees. So let's get started. First thing first, we need to do a measurement, which means we need to wear what I would most likely want to wear under my new transparent raincoat. So let's look at the waist. Waist is about 40 inches. Let's look at the chest. The chest is about 41, 42 inches. So, to leave a little room inside, a minimum of 45 inches in the waist for the new raincoat, and maybe a minimum of 45 to 50 on the chest of the new raincoat. So, let's do this. Since I do everything ad hoc, I'm going to roll out a length of the plastic for the back, with that's about 25 inches. 25 inches on the front plus 25 inches on the back, you add 25 plus 25, and that is 50. That's third grade arithmetic. and 50 should be ample. So let's get started with that.
I never measure anything at a time. I design it as I make it, and I try to eyeball it. If it's close, it's fine. I've had enough positive comments in my clothing that I make, so I know that this kind of work people like. So what I'm going to start with, in the back, we have the yoke, which is the small part right under the shoulders. And the yoke bows out to allow room for your back, which is generally wider at the top. So what I'm going to do, this is the top of the back, the yoke will go here. I'm going to just do a cut like so, it's curved, so when this is sewn to the yoke, it will kind of push it out, allow room inside. Now, the neck, of course, cut will be in the yoke. I don't have to worry about that. But I'm going to do the lower part of each sleeve. So we're going to start here, like so. We're going to go in, down at right angles to the cut here, and then we're going to go back inward, something like that. This will be the lower part of the sleeve. And below the sleeve, we're going to do the skirt of the coat. Now, the person is about a 35 or so waist, so a 45 or larger coat would be ample big for this person. But right now, this is the back, and it's folded in half. We are approximately 14 inches at the top of the back. The 14 plus 14 is 28. The 28 plus 28 is 56. So that's plenty big. So I'm going to start here and come in to about, say, oh, let's try 12 inches at the bottom, because 12 plus 12 is 24. 24 plus 24, front and back, about 48, which is plenty big. What I'm going to do is to start at a right angle cut here at the bottom of the armhole and come in like so, gradually, until we come to the 12 inches halfway across the back. Something like this. Now, what we have here is the lower back of the coat. Now, we have to do the yoke next. So what I've got here is the piece that I'll be cutting the yoke from. Now, this is the top of the back. I've got the fold, the middle of the back, and the middle of the yoke lined up. So I'm going to cut the bottom of the yoke. Now the yoke will have the opposite curve as the back, so when the two are sewn together, there'll be room, it will create kind of a bubble inside, room for the person's back. So it's going to do something like this. Okay, so now that's the top of that's the back of the yoke. Now the top of the yoke is going to go approximately, so I'm going to do a straight line cut for the top of the yoke, knowing that there'll be, first of all, there'll be a neck cut, and then there'll be the shoulders. So I'm going to, first of all, do a straight cut, something like this, then I'm going to come down and do an initial cut for the neck, something like this. Now, this will be refined later as soon as I stitch the front of the coat to the yoke. Then we'll do a proper sizing for the neck. Now, we're going to do the shoulders.
which will look something like this.
Now what I've done is lined up the yoke to the back, and when I sew, I start from the center because my measurements to the end are not exact, so I'd rather sew from the center, first in one direction, then on the other direction, and if there's misalignment, I'll take care of them later after the stitch is done. So what I'm going to do is mark the center. Now I find when I mark clear vinyl, a ballpoint pen will mark it pretty well, enough to at least line the center up when I get it into the machine. So now the center is marked. Now here I have the yoke and the top of the back lined up. The two centers are lined up. I'm going to put them to the center in the machine. That will be stitched first. So I'm going to start with, I'm going to stitch the two pieces together, leaving about a half inch seam allowance. When I'm done with this stitch, then I'll lap seam it by pushing the seam over and running a second stitch. I'll show you. So right now I'm just going to simply go from the center of the back to one side, I'll turn it around and do the other side. I'm going to get started. Now I just did one half of the back. Now I'm going to turn it over and do the other half. And now, we just did a stitch for the entire top of the back. Now, you see that it's misaligned here and misaligned here. I will cut these to the proper length later, but right now I want to do the second stitch, which means we're going to take the yoke and lay it flat, pull it out. So now we lay the seam flat. We take this and we fold it flat under, and we're going to run a second stitch. This is called a lap seam. So it's a double stitch seam, which makes it far stronger than a single stitch. Now, I have taken the back of the coat and folded it in half carefully so there's a neck. I do a garment. My philosophy is if there's a mistake of about a half inch from side to side, or even an inch side to side, people will not notice it on the street or in public. I have never gotten comments, and I've had garments where there's as much as 2 inches different from side to side. So, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We're going to start right here. I'm going to go at right angles down and start the curve in like so. Now, we've got shoulders or a proper length. Okay, we're done stitching the back. As you can see, the back has got the yoke stitched on it, and the yoke has got a fairly good amount of room for my back. I did make a mistake on the sleeve. They're a bit too large, so I glued an extra piece on here so it makes the sleeve smaller. So now that the back is done, I'm ready to do the front. What I did was to create 2 panels for the front. The stitch seam here, this is for the snaps. I'm going to do that ahead of time so I can do the sizing correctly. I'm going to lay the 2 panels for the front right on top of each other. So the front seam is lined up. We don't care if the other side is lined up, because that will be the cut. Then what I have to do is I'm going to take the back. This is the back of the coat folded in half. So the front see the front, I'm going to call it hem, front strip, will line up with the center of the back. And in fact, it will line up a little bit outside of the center of the back, because usually the front of the garment is
a little bit bigger than the back. We allow a little room, additional room for the front. So what I have to do, I'm going to cut the collar. Now the front collar always goes lower than the back collar. So it goes something like this. So I'm going to cut the front collar something like this. And here's the shoulder. Then the sleeves, the arm openings, we cut it exactly the same as the back. And then we go down the sides. So I just eyeball it, provide a little extra room in the front so the side would not be quite the same as the back. It's gonna be something like that. There that, and now, we have the two sides of the front cut. So here's the back and here's the front. My next step is to stitch the shoulders of the front to the shoulders of the back. Now I'm just completing stitching the back to the front. Now you can see the effect of the yoke seam. It creates kind of a dome in the back of the coat. So I'm just going to very briefly put it on. You might be able to see how the back, there's room in the back. Now I got a lot of things to do. First of all, I deliberately make the collar very, very small, so then that way I can iteratively cut it larger and larger until it fits just right. Now I'm done sizing the collar, plus I'm done putting the temporary closures on the coat. And a few things I would like to point out at this time. I'm gonna step closer and hopefully you can see how the plastic is tight against my skin, which means you look in the back, all the fabric of the coat itself is under the plastic, both on the shoulders, the sides, as well as the back. Everything is inside the clear plastic raincoat. That's important to me, especially with this homemade clothing, to ensure that it stays dry. That's why I'm willing to put up with a little discomfort with the plastic pressed tightly against my skin. Now that's not the only precaution I'm going to take. First of all, the collar will have a collar piece that will be stitched to the collar, which will be several layers of plastic rolled in a strip to have strength for the collar. In addition to the collar, there'll be three snap fasteners I'll put on this collar for the purpose of attaching a detachable hood. Now here's a very important step that I do when I make my own homemade raincoats or clothing. You notice I'm using masking tape to temporarily keep the coat closed. When you make a garment, after you make the vest part of the garment, before you stitch the sides closed, of course you have to attach the sleeve. Then you do the final stitching on the underarms, the sleeves, down the side of the coat. That is a lot of work to do, only to find that the garment's not fitting. So what I'm doing, I'm going to try to preempt that by doing a temporary closure of the entire vest part of the coat with masking tape to ensure that the fit is okay. I have room inside. This is how the front will look. This is how it'll look on the sides. Hopefully my arms are out of the way. You can see how much room there is in the back and see the effect of the yoke seam. I'm going to show you the back. You can now see
I'm trying to get my arms out of the way. You can see how much room there is in the sides. I'll show you the other side again. See, there's room in the back, room in the front. And I'm going to stoop down and prove there should be enough room to sit down. If there's any problem at this point, I will stop what I'm doing, take these materials, set them aside, and start a whole new project. Now, mind you, I will not throw this away if that happens. When I have time later on, I will proceed to complete this coat. Knowing that it's too small for me, I will simply give it as a gift to a friend of mine. At this point in time, my next step will be to make and attach the collar to the coat. Once I do that, I'll attach the snap fasteners on the collar for the hood, as well as the snap fasteners on the coat itself. Now here is the collar piece I just completed. It's the one stitch on the one edge, and I cut the other edge off. Here is the coat. Here's the opening for the collar that I just properly sized. I'm going to take this edge here, and I'm going to place it along the opening like this with some overlap. I deliberately made this too long. Okay, I zoomed in a little closer. So what I've done is I just completed stitching the collar piece to the coat with the collar piece flat against the coat, and I did a single stitch, as you can see where my finger is, about 3/8 of an inch from the edge. And this all goes all the way through the width of the collar. Now again, I had to be very careful to stitch maybe only 1 inch at a time and to line up the coat to the collar and keep on going. This is a slow, iterative process. Now that this is done, I'm going to take the collar, I'm going to lay everything flat and take the collar piece, fold it over like this. So you can see that the collar is folded onto itself and the coat. And I'm going to do a single stitch. My finger is about 1/4 inch from this edge. And this will hold the collar flat against itself, like a lap seam. This would be a double seam, which will enhance the strength of the collar. So when we get started, let's start at the outer edge, like this, 1/4 inch in from the very edge. Here we go. Now again, I only go about an inch at a time to ensure that everything is properly folded and pressed flat and there's no puckering. Clear vinyl of this gauge is very tricky because it does pucker and it does stick. You have to take every little bit very slowly and only a small amount at a time. This is basically how the collar will go. I'm going to do the rest of the collar off camera. Now, the snaps are on, both in the front as well as around the collar for the hood. I'll show you a little later. Now, one more time, I'm going to do a verification of the fit. Notice I'm using masking tape on the side. So we still have appropriate room inside the coat for the chest and the waist. And I'll turn to my side. You can see this room in the back. The seam for the yoke helps there, also helps the coat hang properly. I'll show you the back. See, plenty of room in the back for me to move around, as for air to move around to keep me a little bit cooler. Show you the other side. get my arms out of the way. So it looks like we're all set for sizing. Now we're zoomed in a little closer. I'm going to show you the neck and the detail on the front. And first of all, I put my snaps about every 5 inches to ensure that the coat will not flop open in the wind. Most commercial raincoats have snaps about 10 inches or a foot apart, which is too far. Now look carefully at my collar. You see that the vinyl is pressed fairly firmly against my skin. It feels a little tight. However, the important thing is if you look carefully at my side, at my front, and my back, you notice that all of the fabric for my homemade clothing is completely inside my transparent plastic raincoat where it will stay dry. Now I'm going to show you the hood. Here is the hood. The two end snaps hold the hood closed. The three middle snaps correspond with the snap in the center of the back and a snap on either side. So now I'm going to proceed to put the hood on. I will put the center snap on first. Put the two side snaps on. Like so. Then I'll close the hood with the snaps on the hood. Now, if you look carefully, the material for the hood is held firmly to the outside of the material for the raincoat. I'll try to let you look a little closer. The back. Now in the front, again, the hood is up against the raincoat, which means that water will fall onto the hood, come down the back of the hood, and just easily go down the back of the coat, which will keep me dry, and most importantly, more important than myself, keep this clothing dry. So it looks like we're all set. We got the proper fit, and the hood snaps on okay. My next step is to work on the sleeves. Now here's the opening for the sleeve in the coat. Now this is the front of the coat. This is the shoulders, this is the yoke is here, and here's the back. This is often called the armhole. What I'm going to do is grasp it at the end and stretch it tight over the scaling, which is on this cutting plate on the table. 0 inches is here, and it counts up to my right. I'll try to stay out of the way of the camera. Here I go. I'm stretching this tight so it's a straight line, and I'm getting about 28 inches end to end. And now, bear in mind that the stitching seam, when I stitch the sleeve to the armhole, the line would be 1/2 inch in from the edge. Like where my thumb is, that's approximately where the stitching line would be. That's just what's called the seam allowance. Now that line is going to be longer than the line formed by the edge. I'm going to make a guess that it will be approximately 2 inches longer. I don't have to be exact, because if I make a sleeve whose stitch line is 2 inches longer, I'm hoping that if anything, it will be exact fit or too large. If it's too large, I'll simply do a pucker on the sleeve under the back where it will not be seen. The last thing I want to do is to have to cut either the back or the front of the coat itself. Here is a length of clear vinyl. It's actually 4 layers. It's folded in half, and folded in half again. So the sleeves will be cut, the shoulder of the sleeve will be here, it will be cut something like this. And then the sleeve itself will be cut something like this. This is the center of the sleeve. This is waist here. Now, since the sleeves are never straight, the sleeves are always cut at a curve, something like this. That's true with any coat or shirt. So what I'm going to do is, I'm first going to go up to the very edge, and I'm going to cut a curved cut, something like this, okay? Now, let's measure that. Now, this may or may not be enough. If it's not enough, we'll go ahead and get another roll of plastic and start again. So I have to measure around the edge. We have 15 inches on the half. Now remember, we're folding in half, so we're going to stitch, and actually it's close to like 16 inches or so, which is fine, because if it's too much, we'll pucker it. And now I'm going to cut the material right at the edge here. I'll turn around like this. Then I'm going to come in. This is the bottom of the sleeve. And we're going to come and then go straight to the end of the sleeve like this. Now, this is deliberately too long for my arms. I will worry about cutting this to arm size once I put the coat on with the sleeves attached to it. One of the last things I'll do is cut the sleeve to length. And I have to accommodate with a fold back with a hem of the sleeve. So what you see here, first of all, this is the front of the coat. So this is the front underarm of the sleeve of the coat. And this is the side. This is the armhole here. Now here I have the sleeve. This is the underarm of the sleeve. This is the edge of the sleeve that goes along the armhole. I'm going to line up the two edges like so. We're starting the underarm seam. Underarm of the sleeve, and we're going to stitch along the edge of the armhole. Now, when I do stitching in vinyl, or stitch like this, I go anywhere from 3/8 to 1/2 inch seam allowance. That means my stitch line is between 3/8 and 1/2 inch from the edge of the fabric. So here we go. Now because I'm sewing two curved pieces, I have to take this very slowly and very carefully to ensure that the pieces are aligned and that nothing is puckering. Now we're near the end of the stitch, and as I predicted, there's a little overlap on the part of the sleeve. So here I'm going to do a pucker. Generally, I try to keep the pucker as close to the armpit as possible. I'm going to stitch to within about an inch or so from the end of the seam, about here. Then I'm going to back stitch. To do that by pressing a lever. Every sewing machine should have a means to go backwards. Now I'm going to take the excess material, fold it over the seam I just completed, something like so. Now this is not has to be exact. Remember, this is under your arm, so people will not see this. The object is to have the ends line up. I get it? Fold it over itself like so, and we come to the end, and now we're done. Okay, now I've stitched the shoulder seam, or the sleeves on, with just a single stitch. And now, as you can see, we have a single stitch, and we have the seam allowance. My next step is to lap the seam, which means I'm going to fold the seam over, if you can see it, like so, and stitch along this edge where my finger is. So now we have a double seam. Now when dealing with sleeves, I find it best to fold the seam up sleeve, that's towards the body of the garment. Commercial shirts and coats seem to be generally made with lap seams folded towards the garment. So I'm going to do that. I'm just going to show you the first few stitches, then I'm going to proceed to stitch, to lap stitch both of these seams off camera. So we start something like so. Maybe since this is a 3/8 inch to a 1/2 inch seam, let's do a 1/4 inch to be safe from the others. I'm stitching 1/4 inch away from the seam that I have just finished. Now the lap seams for the armhole seams are done. My next step is quite simple. I'm going to zoom back for a minute to show you. I'm going to now, on both sides, do the first underarm seam, which will be about 1/2 inch in from the edge of the fabric under the arm. It's important that the armhole seams line up where my finger is. If there's any misalignment, I'll have to do an additional pucker here. What's very important here is that when I do this, I want to make sure that the raincoat is right size out. Now here are the snaps, the outside of the snap, because once this is stitched, it's extremely difficult to flip or make or pull the raincoat inside out. So let's get it in the right direction first. This is a very simple sewing job. I'm not gonna bother showing it online. I'm just gonna do one stitch on the underarm and in the inseam of the hem, inner outer hem of the garment, whatever you call this seam. Do that on each side. I'll do one last fitting, try it on, because the next step after that is where I do the lap of the underarm seam. And that's going to be the most difficult part of the entire raincoat. I want to take these seams here. See this seam here? And I want to fold it like so to the back, toward the back of the coat. Then I want to make another seam to hold this flat like a lap seam. There's a problem. How do you get the sewing machine inside the sleeve to do this seam? That is the big question. And you're going to do a very difficult task of pulling the sleeve under the raincoat. We're going to start from the bottom of the coat, the opening of the coat, like the inside of the coat, like this. And we're going to put the foot inside the coat, getting ready to go inside the sleeve. So I have to pull the garment back. Now this is going to be very difficult because the garment is going to be hung here against this, but I have to pull it all the way back to the end of the sleeve so the foot and the needle will be at the end of the sleeve. So we're going to have a lot of the sleeve bunched up against this part of the machine, the head of the machine. On a home sewing machine, this may not be possible, because we're going to need a lot of room under the arm of the machine. At that point, unfortunately, you may have to use what's called a piping, a decorative piping for the bottom seam. Now here's a suggestion that might help in working the sleeve back through the machine. If you stand behind the machine, notice my hand, put your hand inside the sleeve. You can see my finger right here behind the foot. What I do when I'm getting the material placed, I take advantage of the fact that when the foot is down, there's pressure on the material that will not tend to come back. What I'm going to do now is lift the foot manually. Then, with my hand right here,
That will prevent the plastic on the top of the sleeve from sticking on the plastic in the bottom of the sleeve. That's been to cause a lot of the frustration in trying to do this, is the plastic sticking together. So I'm trying to take advantage of using my hand or anything to keep the plastic separated as I pull it back through the machine. When I get to a point where I need to readjust things, I then will put the foot back down. If necessary, since I'm not stitching, I'm going to increase pressure on the foot just for now, for the purpose of holding it steady as I, maneuver the material behind the foot. What I do is try to get the plastic away from the plastic on top, away from the plastic on the bottom, and try to get it bunched up on the top against the head of the machine. Once I've maneuvered it, then I'll proceed to manually lift the foot of the machine. Then go back a few inches. Sometimes doing this, you may only be able to go back an inch, just 1 inch, put the foot back down, re-maneuver things behind the machine. May have to get the plastic back against the head of the machine. You don't really want anything right here with my fingers, otherwise it may get pulled in while you're stitching. You do your maneuvering, then you lift the foot back up and pull some more back under the foot until you get to the point you can't do it anymore. Put the foot back down and continue the process. The foot is now at the beginning of the sleeve. Right now, I'm going to start stitching. Now, bear in mind, there's so much material very close or adjacent to the foot. You do not want to let the material double up under the foot while I'm stitching. I'm going to take this a few stitches at a time. Now, since there's enormous pressure on the material at this point, I don't know if I can do the back stitches to lock the end of the seam here. If I can't, then I'll have to glue it later on. That's probably about it. So, we've started the stitching. Now as we get through the sleeve, this will get easier as the pressure on the material will lessen as more of it goes back out from under the machine. So I'm going to continue to do this slow process. Now that my raincoat's completed, I'd like to very briefly discuss a few items that I did not do on camera, mainly because they're quite simple and a bit tedious. The first one is the hem for the sleeve. All I did here was to take the end of the sleeve and folded it back on itself twice. Then I sewed a simple seam around the circumference of the sleeve. With a hem at the bottom of the coat, if you look carefully, I folded the bottom of the coat twice on itself. I folded it once, then I stitched a single stitch along the outer edge. Then I folded it again and sewed yet another stitch. So you have two lines of stitching and it's folded twice. That provides strength. Very important for me in making garments is that all the seams are first of all double stitched like this and they're anchored. I've got a story to tell you. I went into Mario's, a very high-end clothing store in Seattle, and I saw a Prada designer raincoat, clear plastic raincoat, selling for $950. One thing I noticed, they only had a single stitch here, and they had no hem. All they had was piping up to the stitch. They failed to anchor the stitch in the piping. In the rack, that single stitch, that was not anchored properly was starting to unravel about 3 inches. Because of that unraveling, they marked the price from $950 to $650. That was my lesson to ensure that all my seams are double sewn and they're firmly anchored. The last thing I want to show you is the bonnet. I didn't show making the bonnet. This is fairly simple. You take 2 pieces of vinyl and you do a single lap on one and a double lap on the other. You lay them so that the double lap is about 2 inches below the single lap. Then you cut an arch like this. Then you just stitch the arc. The bonnet, as you know, goes over your head like this. So the double lap seam is the neck seam that has the snaps. The single lap seam is the one that goes over my head. This bonnet is rather large. You may want to make it smaller. I just like a large bonnet because it's roomier and it protects me from the rain a little bit better. This is almost, if anything, a little bit too large, but I might as well use it now that I have it. The next garment, next bonnet, will probably be a little bit smaller. Well, the bonnet is quite easy. This took me less than about a half hour to make. So with those, the raincoat is now complete.
Well, hello, it's all done now. Decent fit. So it looks like I am the job successful. Hopefully this video should help you make your own if you want. So right now, I'm gonna skip off onto the rainbow.